All right, so now we're going to begin. I want to say hello and welcome on behalf of BioMint. My name is Ryan Hines. I'm the communications manager, and I wanted to welcome you to this session of the BioMint Antibiotic Reduction Expert Series. Our topic today is keeping pigs with long tails. Is it possible? And to answer that question, I'm joined by our featured expert speaker, Dr. Nicole Kemper, Director of the Institute for Animal Hygiene, Animal Welfare, and Farm Animal Behavior at the Veterinary University of Hanover. Dr. Kemper, good morning. Thanks for joining us.
Yeah, good morning. Hello, hello to everybody. Yeah, I'm really glad to be here and having this webinar with you.
We're very glad that you can join us and share your insights today. It's an interesting topic, whether you have pigs with docked tails or undocked tails. I think there's going to be something for everyone. So before we jump in, why don't you tell us a bit about your background and your focus?
Yeah, of course. So I'm a veterinarian, and after I started veterinary medicine at the University of Leipzig, I specialized in mainly animal welfare and also microbiology, animal hygiene. And I changed to the Agricultural University of Kiel. So I also have a strong agricultural background. And over the years, I specialized in mainly a PDS, so postpartum dysgalactia syndrome, and then continued to animal welfare in general. And nowadays, since 2013, I'm here at the University of Veterinary Medicine in Hanover. And we have a lot of projects going on in poultry, but mainly in pigs, and also working with undocked pigs.
Excellent. Thank you for that. Right before we get started, just a brief word to everyone who's listening live right now, from wherever you are in Europe or even further abroad. This is a live interactive session today, and that means two things. So it means first that you'll see on your screen, there's an opportunity for you to use the chat function to post questions directly to Dr. Kemper. And second, we're also able to ask you questions, which we call the audience poll questions. We're gonna use a couple of those during our session in order to get a better understanding to prompt the discussion around this interesting topic. We're gonna jump in with our first poll question right now. So here's your opportunity to participate. So the question for you is, do you raise pigs with long tails? Just to start out, let's see where everyone is. The options, please choose the one that works best for you, is yes, it works well. Yes, but it's very challenging. Not sure, not yet, but considering the shift to long tails, or no, I'm sticking with dock tails. Please go ahead and select the answer that best suits your operation at this moment in time. We see that the answers are coming in. And once we get more than half of everyone voted, I think we're going to go ahead and display those results so that we can have a look at where everyone stands today. All right, and I see that we have many of the votes have come in already. So I'm going to go ahead and close that poll. Let's all have a look at what everyone has to say. Okay, so yes, it works well, raising pigs with long tails, according to 13% of everyone listening. Yes, but it is very challenging, and I hope that we will definitely hear about how to improve on that in just a moment. Not yet, but considering making the shift, and no, sticking with dock tails. So we have an interesting mix of backgrounds and objectives here. Dr. Kemper, how does that correspond with what you see in the field, what you see in industry practice, in particularly in Europe?
Yeah, that's exactly the picture I have in mind when thinking about the situation in Europe. So it's very different from farm to farm, of course, from country to country as well, but we have a very diverse picture, yes.
Excellent. Well, I know that there will be some great information in this presentation for everyone. So without further ado, please go ahead and jump into your remarks.
Yeah, I'll just activate the laser pointer. So, of course, now.
And to advance the slide, you may want to take off the pointer, right?
Yeah, exactly. Just one moment. Some technical. Here we are. So now we can start. Sorry for that. Okay.
Excellent.
So, yeah, we are talking about keeping pigs with long tails today. And the main question is, of course, is it possible? And if yes, how can we do it? And to start with, I will focus first at the European legislation, because here in Europe, the legislation is quite strict. And then we will broaden up and also have a look on how it is, maybe the situation worldwide, and what can we learn maybe from the way we proceed here in Germany or in Europe. So with the European legislation, as you might know, tail docking is banned in the European Union. But of course, we know that tail docking is the most effective way to minimize the risk of tail biting. And while this ban in the European legislation, it was put into legislation a few years ago, and nowadays the EU really wants to enforce this legal ban, and there are national action plans put into practice. And we have to keep pig with long tails on the long run. And there you might ask, what's the point, the big challenge is, how is it possible to keep pigs with long tails without being bitten during the whole time of the life period of a pig? And the really challenging thing is it possible in existing systems? So if you don't want to change everything regarding husbandry and so on, is it possible in existing systems? And the things I would like to discuss with you today is, what prerequisites do we need to manage pigs with long tails until the end of the finishing period, so until slaughtering? And is it possible to have a continuous success? So not only, well, one batch works well, the other one doesn't. So is it continuous? Is continuous success possible or feasible? And then you might ask, if it is possible, due to my experience, maybe in some cases it's not possible, why should we do it at all? Why? Of course, in Europe it's quite clear, because we have to on the long run, but are there any benefits from keeping pigs with long tails, even if we are not legally required to? And is there any benefit of this talk, even if we don't start now with keeping pigs with long tails? And that's one point I really would like to emphasize. Yes, there is a benefit, I hope so, because keeping pigs with long tails is really, so if you are successful in keeping pigs with long tails and keeping them unbitten, it's really a key, feature or a key sign that you can achieve high standards. And animal welfare is getting more and more important, as you know, all over the world. And we are talking here about also antibiotic-free production. And animal welfare is such a key element of animal health and keeping animals in a good way. And the unbitten tail is really a sign that you are able to manage those pigs on a really high standard and a high level. And that's why I'm really convinced that it's so important to think about this topic in more detail. So you can have several attitudes towards tails or undocked tails. And tails are an indicator. And the tricky thing about the whole topic is, tail biting is really multifactorial. So in scientific literature, you have really numbers of factors described that are or are not a cause for tail biting or a trigger for tail biting. So we have this multitude of known triggers, and the easy question might be, oh, which button do I have to press to make it possible to keep those long tail pigs? But yeah, unfortunately, it's not as easy as that. Due to this multifactorial origin, it's in nearly all cases, it's not possible to define this exact factor or button which you do have to press. It's more like this. The attitude which might be more successful is that you are aware that tail lesions are always an indicator that something went wrong before you can see tail lesions. and that's true for docked and undocked pigs, that long before you can see lesions or before the pigs are starting to bite, there has happened something that might be wrong. So you have to prevent tail biting long before you can see anything at the animal. So what I'd like to stress is that's true for long and docked tails. Of course, it's more obvious in long tails that you can see tail biting. And that's really, using tails as indicators for the husbandry in general. Prevent tail biting in tail docked and undocked pigs. Of course, I guess worldwide, most pigs are docked. The situation in Europe still is like this, that the tail docked pigs are the most common ones. And even those tail docked pigs, if you have a closer look at this, show tail lesions in considerable numbers. And of course, it's not in such high numbers that you might expect as in undocked pigs, but you can see it. And the reason why we do tail docking, of course, is that we want to avoid biting, but this mutilation, so this tail docking mask problems, as DJ Santi claimed here in 2016. So tail docking does not eliminate the underlying problems causing tail biting behavior. It's just to reduce the signs you can see. We had a study at the slaughterhouse with about 5,500 pigs, and we recognized via automatic detection that about 1% of all slaughtered pigs showed tail lesions, and that's the number you regularly find in scientific literature. It's almost, in all studies, between 1% and 5% of all slaughtered pigs in tail dog pigs. And you can expect this number is maybe higher, but that's the number which is described. Looking at the factors on tail biting, as I already said, it's a multifactorial situation. And we can divide the factors, if you want to classify them, into extrinsic factors from outside and intrinsic factors from inside the pig. So looking at the extrinsic factors at first, we have the housing conditions and the sanitary challenges. And that's all about good management and, good husbandry conditions. If you have a look here at those factors which are summarized here, we have feed, water, structure of the pen, pen mates, and so on. So we will have a closer look on this later on. And then we have the sanitary challenges. So that's mainly hygiene and the pathogens which are abundant in those pens. And in most husbandry systems, the pigs are kept in a low stimulus environment, so enrichment is usually not present and it's a quite barren environment. And then we have a certain bar marked here in red, and that's the individual pig's threshold to respond to those risk factors which are present. And that's really one key point. We want to keep this threshold as high as possible, of course, that the pig does not respond with tail biting behavior to those factors which are present. And the other bar I have marked here is a more intrinsic factor. It's the individual pig's urge for investigatory or foraging behavior, because tail biting is not an aggressive act. It's an exploratory act. So the pigs want to explore, and as there is nothing to explore in such usually barren environment, they start to explore the pen mates. And this individual pig's urge for investigatory behavior might differ, and it's always a big topic to discuss scientifically if there are certain breeds that are more prone to develop such behavior or not. And you might, even due to your experience, have in mind that, there might be something true about this. So we want to keep this individual pig's urge for investigatory foraging behavior quite low. And to reach these good conditions to reduce tail biting, we have to avoid stress on the one hand and to implement best practice on the other hand. And this best practice I'd like to discuss with you on the following slides. So at first, we can have a look at the different time points where tail biting is occurring. That might differ in several countries based on the management system or the batch management you have. So here I have just the situation for a usual German system with 4 weeks of lactation. And you can see that at least in Germany, the most sensible period for tail biting is around the, well, first or second, mainly the second week in on the flat deck, so in the rearing unit. And there we see the most outbreaks. That situation can completely differ if you have longer lactation periods. Then it is more, the most sensible period is might be more delayed to the fattening unit. So this is an indicator that it's really important to provide a good start. That's already in the lactation period, we have several factors which might influence the tail biting later on. And there are several scientific reviews really putting all this together, this information, and there are a lot of science that it's important to have really good practice already during the lactation period. And the main aim, of course, is that when keeping pigs with long tails, that they still have their long tail at slaughter, so that they won't lose it via biting or being bitten on the way. Implementing best practice on a farm includes best practice on all stages, so health, housing, and management. And best practice on farm is prevention, of course. And here we can see one really important point when talking about prevention and good housing for pigs with long tails. So first, if you have this slide in mind with the housing conditions and sanitary challenges, these factors, we have to do everything to improve all these factors concerning housing conditions and sanitary challenges. Concerning housing, usually I'm talking about the situation in Germany now, and that might be true for most parts of the world. We have fully slatted houses systems for intensive pig husbandry. And even in those husbandry systems, we should do our best to provide space and structure. Space is one thing that's often a little bit overemphasized in especially public discussions, but space is not the only thing that's important. We also have to provide structure. Structure means we have to offer the pigs the ability to use several parts of the pen for the certain behaviors. For instance, as you can see on the one slide, that you really offer them climatic places that are different, so a climatic structure where it's, for instance, warmer or colder. And also these elevated levels, as you can see on the other slide, on the other picture. And this is a good opportunity to offer more structure on the one hand and more space on the other hand. And that's one way to enlarge space in existing systems. The other thing is that they have to access all resources without competition. So for water and food supply, you have to offer them enough access. And you have the pen structure with functional areas. That's really a nice thing if you have the space to do so, that they have one lying part, one part where they can play and move, and one where they can do their or perform the elimination behavior. That's one important point. And then talking about extrinsic factors, one thing that is really of utmost importance and which is discussed a lot is enrichment. Enrichment usually includes material. We have anorganic material like chains, for instance, but the really important thing is organic material where pigs can perform the natural behavior, the rooting behavior, the exploratory behavior. And in the European Union, there's this demand for permanent access to organic material. So it has to be organic, it has to be sufficient, appropriate, and without health risks. Well, talking about health risks, and that's really a point which is important. Health risks in organic material, they are present, and we can see it on the next slide. The daily provision of small quantities of this enrichment material is important, and the pigs should be able to manipulate this material, and of course usually they eat it as well, and that's why it should be without any health risks. But the thing is, and that's the problem in fully slatted systems, if this material goes through the slatted floor, it might cause a blockage in the slurry systems. And therefore, this material should be suitable. For instance, it should be cut, that it doesn't block anything. Or this floor should be partly solid, for instance, with rubber mats and so on. Enrichment material should be changed regularly, and it shouldn't be stored in the compartment directly, because the pigs usually don't like if the material smells like them, so if it already has the pig smell, so without any smell. You can use it also as early intervention tool, so if tail biting is already present, this enrichment material is a good tool to avoid larger outbreaks, so it can help. It's not necessarily the one and only tool, but it should be provided also as intervention tool. For instance, stropped straw is really a good enriched material, but also alfalfa pellets or hay, they really like usually. But you have to be careful, especially with peat. So peat provided for piglets mainly, their Mycobacterium avium was detected, and that's of course a really hygienic risk. And in corn and corn products, mycotoxins play a role. As you can see here on the next slide, we did a study on different materials which are commercially available, and here in the corn pellets and in the corn silage we really find high amounts of DON and SIA, so mycotoxins can be a problem, and I'd recommend not to use corn as enrichment material. Another thing which is especially in the times of African swine fever, especially with enrichment material, a problem is that you really should think about where you get your enrichment material from. So over the last two summers, which were really dry summers here in Europe and Germany, we had the problem that there was a shortage of hay. And as you can see here in this advertisement from the internet, that there's hay from Poland to offer, and that might not be a good idea to get your enriched material for your pigs from sources you do not know, and you do not know which pathogens are carried or are brought into the animal husbandry systems with this material. So that's not, definitely not a good idea. Talking about other extrinsic factors, the climate is another point that should be considered. So you should avoid droughts. So anything with cold air and anything that's really also as a human being not very nice to have. So you should really offer the pigs a good climate, and you should also avoid direct sun, because direct sun can also be a trigger for tail biting. And of course, it should not be too hot and too cold. It's always a nice thing to offer the pigs outdoor access, but of course, this has to be really, also consider that that might be a risk for hygiene or for animal health. So such a outdoor access as in the picture above, that might be nice because it's really an limited outdoor access and no, all the risk is tried to kept low. So air quality is a thing you have to keep in mind. Ammonia, especially in slatted floor systems, is often a problem that we can see. And cleanliness should also be a thing that should be just normal in your pens. So these are the things considering the climate. And here are some pictures to illustrate this. In the picture above, you can see sun and heat stress. And if you have such a nice infrared camera, it's a good option to use it also in the stable and to have a look where there are certain areas where it might be too hot or too cold. Too cold, as you can see in the pictures below. It's always a sign that it's too cold if the pigs are really huddling together and animals are really showing that it's too cold. So we come to back to this later on. Feed and water, as already mentioned, the access to those resources is essential for every pig, so that the pigs do not have to fight for these resources. The quality should be adequate, and you shouldn't have abrupt changes in these resources. So you have to really keep a high quality over the whole time. Both resources feed and water should be sufficient, and there shouldn't be any dietary imbalances, of course, and at least 4% fiber, minerals and amino acids are essential to just provide the pigs with all these necessary things. And especially with regard to tail biting, this feed and water should be without any toxins, as toxins were described to really provoke tail biting.
If I could jump in on that comment right there.
Yeah, of course.
You mentioned mycotoxins as a contributing factor, and you talked about mitigating the presence of mycotoxins. Let's take a moment just now to check with our audience to see if they're doing anything about this factor and how they're managing it right now. So we're going to launch our next audience poll question. Please go ahead and choose the answer that best fits your situation. Do you apply either in your operation or recommend to others a mycotoxin binder for pig diets? The answer choices are yes, no, or not sure. And as we see, those many answers are already coming in. We're going to give everyone just a few seconds to go ahead and select their answer. Once those answers come in, we're going to come back and display the results so that we can do a quick take to see how widespread the application of mycotoxin binders are, at least among our listeners live this morning. We see that we've got roughly half the votes in, so I'm going to go ahead and close the poll. And there's a very clear winner here, Dr. Kemper. When we're looking at this, most of our audience, so a good 3/4, say yes that they're applying or recommending to apply a binder to pig diets. 13% said no, and there were some who are not quite sure whether they're doing so or not.
Yeah, that's an interesting result. So really good from the point of prevention.
Excellent.
Yeah, so I'd like to continue then with the water. So for water, it was shown in some studies, if you have a closer look at the water resources, there are really problems. So concerning drinker flow rates and rates that are too low or too high or wrong animal drinker ratios, as you can see here on the slide, it's really a problem. And that's always as far as I can tell from my experience, it's always a really neglected factor. So water is not, or it became more apparent also in the scientific literature over the last few years, but it wasn't considered for a long time. So that's really a point you have to keep in mind. And an optimum might be 10 animals per drinker in the pens. So then looking to the more hygienic factors, prevention concerning extrinsic factors. So sanitary challenges in times of African swine fever, this should be really on top of your list to provide a really high standard, including all the measures we know concerning biosecurity, and also including pest control. So these points I won't go into detail today, but yeah, this whole block is really important. And another point which from our experience is essential is the so-called human factor. So the humans or the people on farm, the person on the farm is the key element in keeping pigs with long tails successfully. So you have to have persons that are really good in looking at the animals and seeing early signs of tail biting before outbreaks are going to happen. So as it was shown in one study, the intensified human-animal interaction can decrease tail biting behavior. And as a farmer's eye is really essential for prevention. It's a big task to have all these factors in mind and to improve or to implement this best practice. But a more or even more challenging it is to have those daily look at the animals and really see those who are bitten, but also to identify maybe the biters. So concerning the animal intrinsic factors, as I put it on the slide before, which are the more factors inside the animal, animal health is key. And as long as animal health is not on a very high level, you won't be able to keep pigs with long tails. So it was shown that controlled immune stimulation with lipopolysaccharides increased tail and ear-directed behavior. So you really should do everything to have bacterial infections on a low or on a zero level on your farm. You should purchase pet pigs without any predisposition. And one important thing is that vaccinations have to be correct. So vaccinations have been shown to reduce the risk of tail and ear biting significantly, and you have to have this good animal health level. And another point which is often not so optimal on farms is the provision of hospital pens. There should be enough in order to really separate diseased pigs but also bitten pigs. Social interaction between pigs is really important to reduce competition. It might be different regarding on the pig chain how to put this into practice, but it is recommended to keep litters together after weaning and to avoid mixing a lot. So three litters is one number you can find that can be put together. The pigs should be of comparable size, and they should really, this first period of fighting should be short. Concerning genetics, as I already mentioned, there are no scientific studies really indicating that there are differences between breeds or lines, but at least from practical experience, there might be differences in the individual reaction to stress and in the locomotory and investigating behavior and in their reactions on toxins. Concerning prevention, just very briefly, early warning signs are the tail position. Tail position can show you if the pigs are in a good condition or if there's something wrong and tail biting outbreak might happen. If the pigs are really hanging down and tucked between the legs, that's not optimal. The pig's tail should be curled, and you can see this, of course, only in undocked pigs, and that's quite nice to see then. Animal observation, as already mentioned, is key. Having this eye on the pigs, and as soon as you can see, for instance, belly nosing or this urgent need to explore orally, there might be something wrong. And here I've got some videos for you. I hope they're working. So just one example of belly nosing. Most of you have seen this before. I guess that was quite loud. Here you can see how it is going on in circles. And here you can see in this video a desperate activity, really an urgent need to explore. And I'll just put it on shortly because it's, or for a short time because it's too long now. But I want to stress, as you can also see here and in some parts, those pigs are also affected by ear necrosis. And ear lesions are always, as tail lesions as well, a sign that there might be something wrong with the pigs. And those pigs are really, behaving not normal. They're really, they have this urge to explore. And it was shown that there were high mycotoxin levels present in the sow's feed. One word to ear lesions. So tail lesions and ear lesions are closely related. So do not start with undocked pigs as long as ear lesions are present in the pigs. That you won't be successful. For prevention, you have to have an emergency plan to treat and separate affected pigs. And those pigs should be treated against the pain and the inflammation, so call the vet in case of emergency. And then, and that's a difficult task, you should identify and separate the biter. If there's only one, there might be also more. You should separate them, and then, of course, you should check what might be wrong and optimize those lacking resources or factors and provide suitable material. The thing about continuous success, and that's one quite frustrating thing, that even farms with high standards will experience outbreaks, and that shouldn't keep you from keeping pigs with long tails, but these farmers should be really supported. And in case of larger outbreaks, which are especially frustrating, there should be further diagnosis, especially with regard to infectious diseases, for instance. And pigs with poor prognosis should be really culled consequently. That's also often a point which is neglected. Here is one positive example where you can see really shiny pigs with curled tails. And as you can see on the video soon, they are also chewing a little bit on the tails, but that's not such a really urgent behavior or obsessive behavior. They're just really in a good and calm mood. And here you can also see those water supplies, those sprinklers, which they really like. And as you can see, it's, on the other hand, a really normal system, not with solid floor, but really good and shiny pigs. This is a positive example that it is possible. So the farmers, the veterinarians, and the pigs should be fit for purpose. The best practice on farm should be implemented concerning health, housing, and management. It's a slow process usually. You should develop stepwise, step by step, not keeping all the pigs at once, starting with all pigs at once, but maybe with one pen or one compartment. Veterinarians should support, of course, the farmers. And in Europe, it's still the situation that you need permission to keep tail dog pigs, and the veterinarian should document these needs. The veterinarian, of course, can provide knowledge and help in cases of outbreaks, And for all of us involved in this big task of keeping pigs with long tails, it's always good to be optimistic that someday it is possible and it can work out. And on the long run, yeah, you have to be really, well, optimistic, because based on experience, that might hold true for you as well, it can take up to 2 years to reach the goal for the whole group of pigs. That's one example, before and after consultants. So concluding, keeping pigs with long tails is possible, but it's not easy at all. So there are high demands on management, and all actions to preserve the tail are beneficial for production too, and of course also for antibiotic-free animal husbandry too. And well, for the discussion, just a few points before keeping pigs with long tails into practice. There are still a few open questions which can be solved, I'm sure. So solutions for existing systems with fully slatted floors, how can we handle this? How can we handle the farmer's individual capacity? Are there any tools to really get the farmers learned those things? One ethical question, which is not really major, but often raised, is the suffering of bitten pigs larger than the suffering by docking? That's really difficult to discuss, which percentage of bitten pigs do we tolerate. But here you can also always argue that docking is applied to all animals. Bitten pigs hopefully do not occur in as a whole batch of pigs, and you can treat those pigs with a medicamental treatment. The economical question, which is often discussed very diversely, or no, controversially, that's the word, who pays the extra effort? Is it all paid by the farmer themselves, and do they have really a benefit for instance by better performance of the pigs, or is there a certain amount paid by whosoever? So that's it from my side. Thanks a lot for your attention, and I hope we have enough time for discussion now. Thanks.
Absolutely. Thank you for those remarks, Dr. Kemper. Certainly some interesting points that you've raised, and those have sparked a number of questions that we're going to jump into right now for our Q&A. So thank you for everyone who has submitted a question. We're going to fill out the rest of the hour, trying to answer as many of those as we can get to. But if not, we will find a way to follow up with each of you online for those of you who took the time to ask Dr. Kemper a question. Let's start a bit with the point that you left on there. In terms of the benefits and the question of economics, you mentioned that there, in a way, this is an indicator of a system that is performing, that is operating at a high standard. And there are benefits in raising pigs with long tails, because if you can do it successfully, it brings a number of other things to the producer. Is there a way to quantify that? What is there a number figure that you can put around the benefits of raising pigs with long tails?
Well, it's always difficult because it's so individual on farm. So usually you have to do really exhaustive calculations on the individual farm and to have a closer look. So if we do consultants, we really usually get another person from which is more specialized in economics, and then we do the calculations. But of course, there are scientific papers which really try to quantify the benefit, especially on performance and weight gain. And there was one nice paper already in 2012 from Pastorelli, and they tried to quantify what sanitary challenges really do on a weight gain and performance on growth. And they calculated how the growth is reduced by certain factors. For instance, they said that really LPS challenge decreased the weight gain in general about 30% regarding really the weight gain. And also the most important factor were bacterial digestive diseases, so infections on the intestinal tract, and that was a factor about 40% of growth reduction, but also sanitary deficits in general showed a high impact. So there you can really see that the weight gain was decreased, and those are all factors related to tail lesions and tail biting. So there you can really see that there is this impact.
Yeah, absolutely. So definitely some large percentage changes. Thank you for sharing those numbers with us. I want to go back to the occurrence of tail biting. So you mentioned the 1% number as a result of a study, and that this is a worldwide problem. So how big of a problem is tail biting today? And what number should be a concern or a trigger to say, okay, now this is a problem, I need to do something about it?
Oh, well, there you have to, we mentioned 2 points. So on the individual farm level, I'd say as soon there is just one pig biting, you have to do something. So I would draw a zero line, so of acceptance. At slaughterhouses worldwide, usually in tail dog pigs, so the studies which are available are usually in docked pigs, it's always between 1% and 5%, which is documented. But due to our own experiences, if you have a closer look at the slaughterhouse to certain batches which are delivered, you can see really large differences. You have batches with zero tail biting, and it goes up to nearly, 80% of bitten pigs, which you can really see at the slaughterhouse. And there you have to keep in mind that you usually the number or the prevalence on the slaughterhouse, which you can detect, is lower than in real life, so in living pigs. So yeah, we have a problem here, and it's worldwide the same, I guess.
All right, and so it sounds like you're suggesting that no tolerance is the best policy. So even before it gets to that stage, you shouldn't.
Well, on the farm, it's no tolerance for me, but of course I know that it can't be realized in all cases. But 80% of a slaughter pig batch is too high, of course. And here you really, we are also discussing a lot with slaughterhouses how to implement such benchmarks. And it's always good to look over the long run, not just a single batch is delivered, but batches from the same farms over the year, and then compare it to the other ones and to define a threshold. And I guess then we come to maybe 2%, which can be accepted at the moment, or which is acceptable. But that's still a big point of discussion.
Yeah, absolutely. So that's fair. Interesting. We have a question here about some of the indicative behaviors you mentioned. So this regards belly nosing. So is belly nosing, is this more related to the animal's behaviors setting up dominance, especially during 5 weeks of age, rather than an early sign of tail biting?
So belly nosing is not an aggressive behavior, or which is not related to, defining the rank order or whatever. It's really exploratory behavior. And you can often see it in pigs which are weaned really early, or which are raised not by the mother, but by artificial nursing systems or so. And there you can detect a lot of belly nosing. And it's always a sign that the pigs were not able to fulfill the needs for contact with others, especially with the mother, and the exploratory behavior. So it's not related to rank position. And one interesting point in this context is that you can really see if it's aggressive behavior or exploratory behavior if you look at the parts which are the target of the behavior. So if the pigs are really attacking the head, the front, the shoulders of the counterpart, then it's aggressive. And exploratory behavior is more related to ears, to the soft parts of the body, so for the belly, for instance, and of course for the tail, because the tail is really interesting for pigs.
Right. Okay. Well, thank you for making that distinction there. Now we have a question that comes from the Netherlands, where we have a number of listeners this morning. You We're speaking mainly about fully slatted floors, but in the Netherlands, it's required by law to provide 40% closed floor in terms of floor space in the system. So what is the best choice on how to build this in using some of those other factors that you spoke about regarding structure, et cetera?
Yeah, if you already have the situation with a plain floor or not fully slatted floor, as we have, of course, also in the Scandinavian countries and so on, that's always a better situation than we have in the fully slatted floors as we have in Germany. And providing structure here, of course, you have the structure even on the floor. And then it really depends on the individual farm, how much space is there available to structure the pens even more, for instance, by separating walls or whatever, to provide structure or to keep an elevated level. It really depends on the individual situation on the farms of what we can do and how we can provide also enriched material or bedding material and so on.
Yeah, okay. And staying with flooring, we had another question here. What's the experience in terms of tail biting on plastic slats versus concrete in the nursery? Do you have any data? Have you seen anything in that regard?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I haven't any scientific data as far as I can remember, but plastic floor is, of course, often louder than a concrete floor, and noise is related, or increased noise levels are related to increased tail biting behavior. So you can find in several recommendations that it's not recommended to keep or to have plastic floor due to the noise level.
Mm-hmm. And I want to come back. We have another question about the 1% figure that we've discussed now. This was a measurement of the severe tail lesions. Is that correct? Rather than milder or other kind of damage?
Yeah, so on the slaughterhouse, via the system we used for the evaluation, you usually will detect more severe lesions. So the really light lesions or not so severe lesions you won't detect, because we use the system after the pig's carcasses are put into the hot water and so on. So this really slight lesions you won't detect then. Yeah, it's true.
Okay. So that means with these more mild cases, the instance of this behavior could actually be much higher.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So that's why I mentioned that on slaughterhouse, the number of prevalence or the amount of detected pigs is usually lower than really on farm assessment.
Yeah. Okay, thanks for that clarification. We have a question here that regards diet. What fiber sources would be the best in order to counteract the aggressivity? So is there a feed ingredient that would be more beneficial than others in this regard?
Well, I think I can't answer this in whole or completely. It always depends on the diet in general, and it also depends on which enriched material you have and if those fibers are already maybe covered by the enriched material. And straw is always a good thing, and it is described as one of the best enriched materials, but also alfalfa might be a good source. And well, the other thing is more a question to animal nutritionists, I guess.
Absolutely. Okay. Let's see, we have more broad picture questions talking about, do you see any signs that regulation in the EU will change in the coming years?
I know, definitely not. I think the way in the EU is really clear, and they won't change it as far as I can judge it.
Understood. And as regards the topic more broadly, do you see any interest in tail biting from consumers, welfare organizations, from retailers, for example?
Well, at least in Germany, I do, because animal welfare and also tail biting is of high interest in all of the major retailer or in these organizations, and also from the consumers organizations. it's not the case that really, well, how do we say? So it's more for the specialized circles that tail biting is so on their mind. So for the usual citizen, tail biting is not a topic which is so on the top of the list as, for instance, castration or so on. But from the retailer side and the programs they have, tail biting is always on top of the list. And here, really a lot of things are going on to increase the number of undocked tails and to, in the high standard programs.
Okay, so it sounds like from your vantage point, there is some growing interest.
Yeah, it is.
In the issue. We have a question that regards to the timeframes. You identified a few periods that are particularly acute when it comes to the instances of tail biting. Here, the question is about newborn piglets. What are the risk factors for tail biting during the lactation period?
So risk factors are during the lactation period are usually the risk factors which are contributing to uneven litters. So for tail biting or for the prevention of tail biting, you really have to consider all those factors which you also consider if talking about improving even litters. So of course, there's this risk in large litters where you have really pigs with lightweights and has those heavier ones. So a good management, a good lactation management is really a good prevention tool. Cross-fostering, for instance, that you really have litters of the same weight and so on together. And there you should really have a look on, or have an eye on. And the other thing is that even in the sows feeding, you have to be careful which feed you get to the sow, because as mentioned in this one example where the sow's feed was really high in mycotoxins, you can see it later on in the piglets as well. And there you have to really provide also best practice for the sows.
Absolutely. So sticking with that topic of mycotoxins, are there certain mycotoxins in particular that are more associated with tail biting than others? We've had several people ask about ergot alkaloids, for example.
Yeah, alkaloids are a described or scientifically described risk factor, of course. All the toxins which really affect the blood system are described to be a risk factor. And of course, most of the research is on DON and SIA. So the other mycotoxins which might be present, they haven't been considered in scientific literature yet. So I'd say alkaloids, DON and SIA.
Okay, certainly ones to look out for. And then a follow-up question there is, how can you demonstrate the presence of ergot alkaloids in finished feeds, for example? Testing methods.
So I think maybe Biomin is one to answer this question, because I'd say it's in specialized laboratories it's possible via the usual methods of HPLC and so on, so mass spectrometry, I guess. So usually if we are testing for mycotoxins, we are sending those to the special samples to specialized labs.
Absolutely. And for our listeners, you can contact your Biomin representative for more information about support when it comes to testing. So thanks for pointing that out. We have hopefully time for one or two more questions before we close the hour. You mentioned stress as well as a big factor that contributes here. Are there feed ingredients or supplements or any sort of materials that can be supplied to make pigs less nervous, to calm them down?
Well, I don't have any studies in mind that really show that some substances are really effective. of course, from the practical point of view, each farmer or each consultant has several methods or ingredients that might be useful, which they recommend. But I wouldn't recommend any specific ingredient here.
Okay. We have a question about tail biting. Is it also linked to gastroesophageal ulcers? You see anything?
I don't know any studies that really confirm this relation, but if you look at the etiology or the origin of both of those issues, I could imagine that they might be related because they're all or both related to stress and both a sign that something is definitely not all right in husbandry.
Okay, so perhaps something to look out for as well. Just one last question for you then, Dr. Kemper. You mentioned the importance of data and benchmarking and looking at from cycle to cycle, the occurrence and instance of tail biting. So do you think that there's a future in that, that will become more of the solution in the future? Will the development of digital tools, even maybe prediction of the onset of tail biting, help and play a role in solving this problem going forward?
Yeah, that's a good point, because a lot of projects are going on now, especially concerning those early warning signs of tail biting. And there are several approaches to come forward. So there we have, looking at the posture of the tail. So is it hanging or is it curled at one point? Then you can look at the position of the animals, especially with artificial intelligence tools. You can look at, is there more activity in the whole animal group, or are they positioned head to tail, and what's going on? And of course, big data or artificial intelligence really offers opportunities, and future will show if it's really a good thing or not.
Absolutely. Well, I'm certainly looking forward to that. We'll stay tuned and talk to you again if there are developments on that front. Dr. Kemper, I want to thank you for your remarks and sharing your time and insights with us today.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for listening.
Oh, it's much appreciated. And for our audience, I want to thank you for your attention, for your questions and this discussion today. We would appreciate it if you would help by providing your feedback to today's session. Once we close in just a moment, you'll see a questionnaire pop up. Please take just the 2 minutes needed to answer those questions. Let us know what you thought of today's session and how we can improve in the future. You'll also get a chance to indicate if you want a follow-up support and to speak to a Biomin representative. So please go ahead and fill that out. And I wanted to just point out that our series continues in this antibiotic reduction expert series over the course of May, all the way through the end of the summer. We have on May 20th, the zero zinc topic. So an update on how the Danish strategy to replace zinc oxide, and a number of other topics related to gut microbiome, pig health, immunity, and welfare in June and July. So please stay tuned, register for those, and we hope to see you again soon. On behalf of Biomin, I want to thank you again, Dr. Kemper, and thank our audience. We hope to see you again soon. Take care.
Okay.